Okay, hey, in this video, we're going to talk about setting up automated, calibrated turns for your LiDAR situation. So if you're new to LiDAR, you may not know what this is, but if you have been doing this in the field, you know what a hassle it can be to actually have to do these figure eight turns in your setup. So in this video, I'm going to show you how to automate that and speed up your workflow and hopefully make it easier. So without further ado, hey, I'm Dan Abair. And one of the biggest things we're seeing in the market today is how do we get all of this automated so that it's simple and easy to use. And so what we have done, you know, is worked with our friends over at SPH, and I'm going to introduce you to the latest version 4.6 of Universal Ground Control Station. And in this version, what we've added, or what they have added, I should say, is calibrated or calibration turns into the actual workflow. So, you know, what I'm going to cover here today really quickly is we'll talk about what calibration is. We'll show you this automation. We'll show you why it's important. If you stick around to the end, I'm actually going to have some things for you that you can enrich yourself with. And so without further ado, let's jump in. So the first thing I want to talk about is, you know, what is calibration? Let's jump down to our screen. So while I'm talking here, I can kind of show you what this is. So calibration, first off, is set up for a LiDAR system so that it can properly measure what's going on with the system. So if you're not familiar with how LiDAR works, you know, you have a GPS, you have a LiDAR system in there, and then you have an inertial measurement system. And so you know, with MEMS, you know, you have to actually calibrate that sensor. And so it's set up with, you boot up that computer, so you turn it on. Then it's going to go through a course calibration where it's going to find the satellites, its course heading, and measure the IMU in while it's still. And then we're going to take off and fly, and that's what you're seeing on the screen right here, right now, is we're going to do some kind of calibration run that we're actually going to turn the aircraft and measure the dynamic acceleration inside that IMU. And that helps the IMU kind of find it course or finally define its heading, because heading control is very, very important when you're using any kind of inertial system to refine measurement. And you guys, if you're doing terrestrial versus dynamic here, what that really means is a terrestrial system sits there and it's sitting in its own reference plane. When mobile mapping, we are moving the reference plane. And so to refine that telemetry, we need a GPS, we need IMUs, and we need to refine the trajectory of the rover, drone, car, whatever we're going to be using. So that's why these calibration turns are important, because we're calibrating and trying to refine that telemetry. The better the telemetry, the better the LiDAR, okay? It's one of the errors we're trying to reduce. All right, so that's why we use them. Now, when I teach this manually, and so here's a benefit, you guys, you don't need UGCS, you can fly this manually, but if you're, a lot of our surveyors are older and don't really want to be pilots, they want to be surveyors. So, you know, in respect, we automate the heck out of this stuff if we can. So for those guys, we'll come up to the altitude that we're going to be mapping at. I'm going to give it some forward stick, and then I'm going to give it some quarter stick, to the left or to the right. And what I want to do is achieve where I've got constant forward motion and I've got a consistent turn so that I'm going to come around and do a full 360. When I'm done with that 360, I'm then going to take my left stick and I'm going to go the other direction in a nice smooth fashion back around. And I can do that depending on the manufacturer representation and documentation once or twice. Now, what's happening here? So we're actually fine-tuning the accelerometer. Now, in post-processing, and this is where all the magic really happens, now we have all that data so that if you're in POSPAC or Inertial Explorer or whatever other system that you're using, we're going to do either a RTK or a PPK type of setup. And so RTK, we're going to look at time of our process going forward. And so here's our GPS stamps. Here's our IMU data in between. And we're going to take these little segments as we move forward in time. Okay, that's what the rover and the base are actually talking to each other. In post-kinematic processing, obviously we're doing that on a PC, but now we're looking at the whole expanse and we're going forward and backwards to further refine, GPS error in there. And so if we put a calibration in the front and a calibration in the back, it looks the same on both directions, but we get that refinement going forward and backwards. Okay, now, let's say you're trying to, you have an emergency, gotta come home. Have you lost your data? Hell no. Okay, if you're trying to get out that extra 2 acres so that you don't have to take off again, do you need that calibration? No, but it's really nice to have for that further refinement. It could make a subtle difference in there. So that is your personal choice, and that's what we do in our consulting, is I give you the maximum amount of information and you get to choose what's in your workflow. But now you know why it's there, and when you're in the field, you get to make those decisions on what that's going to be. And it could be, a half a centimeter of improvement, and it might not be, and it depends. Again, these procedures are set up for any solution out there. And some folks will say, hey, I'm good with 1 foot contours. You don't need these. And other folks are pushing the envelope and trying to get well below a tenth with these automotive sensors. So, if anybody knows me, I'm trying to get the most out of the most affordable package that I can, until you can get yourself into the higher, more professional LiDAR systems where you can compete against larger contracts. So there is I'm part of adding that progression in there to get you from, where your board of directors will approve just your first system to where you're rocking out several of these things across the United States. All right, so now going back in here, I wanna show you a little bit more about how this works. So in other videos, I go through some of the different settings inside UGCS. I'm not gonna go through all of that today. The big change here is the addition of this pattern tool. And what that now is as that figure eight, where I can come in, I can add the length, the width, the speed, which is great, the number of passes, and I can even change orientation. This is important. And right now we're in Farmer John's field. That's great. But in other places that are more challenging, I may have to restrict where I actually, or the direction that I actually do my figure eights in. So if you're in the Amazon, it's a good case, and you're trying to maintain visual. Now, to tie this kind of all together and how this fits into this, I'm going to come in and let's go ahead and do the LiDAR corridor tool, because I haven't really demoed this yet. So I'll throw in a waypoint, and those guys that take my course know why I put one or two of these in here. And then we'll come in and use the actual, I'm sorry, I lost it for a second. There's our corridor. All right. And so we'll pull this in like this, and let's go ahead and start a corridor. Now, corridors are a little bit different than going and mapping area, in that sometimes you have these weird angles that you need to account for. And so the software that you use, can make or break. So let's see what comes up here. So, here we've got these nice smooth turns where photogrammetry tools and automation aren't going to allow your IMU to work efficiently. I'm gonna scroll out of here a little bit, and let's go ahead and delete this, because I wanna show you in this corridor tool, the piece that is different. And that is, let's see, I'm gonna do a harder turn here. And let's say our pipeline changed direction dramatically. Okay, there we go. So now we have these really tight turns in here, and that if you guys are familiar with how LiDAR actually works, you need a nice smooth flow. So how do you do a nice smooth 90-90 turn that you need for LiDAR when you're turning, let's say 120 or maybe even 180 degrees on it? So there was other things that we used to design to help clients. Now this tool actually allows to put these with teardrop or button hooks in there to automate that workflow for you, and basically increases the accuracy that you're trying to do. All right, now that that is done, what we'll do is we'll just come back here, we'll add another figure eight into the mix, boom. And that is a weird pattern, so we'll just go ahead and reset. I'm not sure why I did that nice funky setup. Okay, perfect. But you can see we can adjust all these settings based on, and I can even come down here, hook the bottom of this thing, pull it where I want it, so that I get the same thing every time. Now, The nice thing about how this works is, you know, it works right now on DJI. Okay, so if you have, in this case, I think I did this on an M600. I did. But, you know, in another video, I showed you how to load this onto an M300 setup. So I'll leave that link right here, right now, up in the upper corner. And like I said, you can do all of this right here. But the big difference is now you get the full power of UGCS with its geo server underneath, its terrain follow, these nice tight calibrated turns, which really do increase the accuracy of your LiDAR system. But now you get the added benefit of now you load this on your tablet here and you walk out and you hit start and you're done. And that's the biggest advantage here. So that's going to save you, well, first off, a lot of frustration, but also time. Because typically what you would see here is that you'd launch, then you'd go off and do your calibration turns, and then you'd be monkeying around trying to find the start button or whatever you were doing. And that's just battery life draining, and we don't want that, right? And, you know, if we can reduce the muscle memory and skill that you actually need to do it so they can do field capture, then that's what this is actually about. Okay, so with that said, if you've liked this, go ahead and hit like, because then more people will get to see this and I can share this content. You know, and if you thought this was beneficial, I'm putting out steady content. So, you know, once or twice a month right now, and that will increase because we're growing and our team's growing, so I can do more of this. So, you know, go ahead and subscribe if you want to, and then leave a comment. You know, if you want to know more about this process or how this works, leave me a comment. I do answer those, and I like those because I make other videos based on what you're telling me, you know, other than you don't like my voice on YouTube. You know, and then for you guys that have UGCS and just kind of want to get that tippet, great. If you don't have the LiDAR module, I'll leave a link down below for both a free trial for you guys who can check this out, and a link for you guys if you want just the LiDAR tools. So if you go to the UGCS website, you'll see that this software is $2,000 to get the LiDAR module. That's expensive. Hit me up. We have a special version of that that's much more reduced that you can only get through MODIS. So I'll have that here where you can use these LiDAR tools and not have to buy the full enterprise version, which is overkill for most companies today. And the last thing I'm going to leave you with is, this is the free offer. I'm going to leave a discount code in the comments below, plus a link to our LiDAR planning course. Now, the LiDAR planning course will show you software. I mean, you'll get free trials of a couple different pieces of software. But the course is designed to take someone new to LiDAR into the business planning process. So I will show you how to do LiDAR planning on UGCS and without UGCS. So if you have a piece of software you really love, I can show you how to do that. But with that, I'm also going to, like the first thing I'm going to show you is the different LiDAR systems out there, what accuracies they actually have and when you would choose them and what are the trade-offs. So a lot of what I do in a business course is talk about ROI and business benefits. And I'm going to talk about the difference between, you know, an entry-level system and what it can do and how much money it will make you versus a high-end system and that investment and what that's going to make you. And I'll talk about those trade-offs. I'll also talk about survey accuracy and target placement and those considerations when you're planning out of where to put them and how that's going to affect your data and your pricing, okay? I will also go into statements of work. So you're going to get statements of work from us. One, to kind of show you how to write your contracts if you want to, how to look at contracts and pull out details. And the last thing I'm going to talk about is actual job pricing. I'm not going to give you the price. I'm going to show you how to derive a price for your industry, your vertical, and your organizational structure. So whether you're a small business or a large enterprise, I'll cover those considerations on how to actually determine what you should be charging, even as the market starts to change. So with that, I hope you like that. Hit the links below. Make offers or make good on some of these things that hopefully will enrich you. And with that, I will see you guys in the next video.